I now hand the conference over to Mr. Debrishi Singh from CDR India. Thank you and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us on the Q2 and H1 FY21 earnings conference call of Jindal Stainless Hisar Limited. We have with us Mr. Abhyuday Jindal, Managing Director, Mr. Ramni Gupta, Chief Financial Officer, and Mr. Gautam Chakraborty, Head Investor Relations of the company. We will begin the call with brief opening remarks from the management, following which we will have the forum open for an interactive Q&A session. Before we start, I would like to point out that some statements made in today's call may be forward-looking in nature, and a disclaimer to this effect is available in the results presentation that was shared with you earlier. I would now like to invite Mr. Abhyuday Jindal to make his opening remarks.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the management of Jindal Stainless Hisar Limited, I welcome you all to this forum. I hope that you and your family are keeping well and safe during these unprecedented times. I will first share key highlights of the period, and then Mr. Ramni Gupta will take you through the key operational and financial highlights. I am happy to say that JSHL has been able to recalibrate and restore normalcy in its business operations by the end of Q2 FY21, following the COVID-19-led challenges that adversely impacted the Q1 performances. This was largely possible due to our agile business model that enabled the company to register a sharp rebound in the operational and financial performance. On a quarter-on-quarter basis, JSHL operational performance was aided by the positive turnaround across sectors. The retail demand, especially from hollowware, i.e. the kitchen and tableware segment, which registered a 5-fold quarter-on-quarter growth during the period, was very encouraging. The company continued to actively cater to the positive demand from metro rail systems, both from India and abroad. JSHL continues to proactively undertake efforts to increase its share from its specialty product division, which largely supplies high-end stainless steel products like precision strips, blade steel, and point blanks to domestic and global markets. I am pleased to report that sales from SPD grew by 14% on an annual basis. Going ahead, the SPD will continue to remain our core growth strategy. During the quarter gone by, JSHL bagged the Energy Efficiency Unit Award at the 21st National Energy Management Award for Excellence in Energy Management 2020. This is organized by the Confederation of Indian Industry in September 2020. I would also like to highlight here that JSHL's plant is the first stainless steel plant in India to adopt the ISO 2018 standard to improve energy management system by improving convenience, adequacy, and efficiency. On the industry front, considering the injury caused to the domestic stainless steel industry due to the dumping from Indonesia for the last couple of years, the government of India has imposed an interim countervailing duty on Indonesian origin material. This has brought temporary relief to the domestic industry, and corrective actions for the long term are awaited by domestic manufacturers. To conclude, I would like to mention that JSHL's sustainable efforts of consistently improving its operational efficiencies and increased value-added offerings will enable us to deliver healthy performances. Furthermore, to optimize cost and enhance customer service, sales from Hisar warehouse is to be increased from third quarter onwards. Going ahead, the company is also well positioned to further strengthen its balance sheet and effectively create notable value for all its stakeholders. Let me also inform you that with the objective to realize greater synergies and maximize value for stakeholders, the board also approved to constitute a committee of board of directors of the company. This committee would explore and evaluate various options of consolidating of stainless steel business of JSHL and of Jindal Stainless Limited and or other group entities of the company by way of scheme of arrangement or otherwise. With this, I would like to hand it over to Ramni Gupta to take you over the financial and operational results. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jindal. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I will now take you through our operational and financial discussions for the quarter and half year ended 30 September 2020. JSHL, with its agile business model, responded swiftly to the overall recovery in demand, which assisted the operating performance for Q2 FY21. Sales volume for the quarter grew 9% on year-on-year basis to 155,470 metric tons. The net revenue stood at Rs. 2,076 crore, up 5% on year-on-year basis. EBITDA for the quarter registered a 3% increase on a year-on-year basis at Rs. 248 crore. The EBITDA per ton stood at Rs. 15,958 in Q2 FY21. The finance cost for the quarter, which stood at Rs. 65 crore, registered a year-on-year decline of 15%. Accordingly, our profit after tax on year-on basis was higher by 35% at Rs. 111 crore. Coming to the half-yearly performance, sales volume for H1 FY21 stood at 2,2884 metric tons, backed by strong recovery in Q2 FY21. The net revenue stood at Rs. 2,819 crore. EBITDA for H1 FY21 stood at Rs. 288 crore and the EBITDA burden stood at Rs. 14,185. The company's consistent focus on deleveraging enabled it to register a 15% year-on-year decline in its finance costs. The company registered a net profit of Rs. 62 crore during the H1 FY21. On the balance sheet front, net debt as on 30 September 2020 stood at Rs. 2,160 crore, while the net debt to equity currently stands at about 1.1 times. The company remains committed to further improving its balance sheet and leverage position going forward. On the whole, we believe that JSHL's inherent strength like its comprehensive product offering with consistent focus on value-added products, a wide distribution network and high brand salience will continue to assist its performance going ahead. This brings me to the end of my discussion. I would now request the moderator to open the line for the question and answer session. Thank you.
Before opening the floor for question and answer, may I request everyone to ask the strategic questions first so that Mr. Jindal can take them. And for the number related and bookkeeping questions, we can do that in the later half. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, please press star followed by one on your touchtone phone now. We have a first question from the line of Jatin Damania from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity and congrats on the good set of numbers. I'll see the EBITDA pattern going up to 15,000. So just wanted to see, because if you look at our SPD, numbers, it's less than 14% growth on annual basis. So as a house or as a company, what is the proposal that we are looking growth in the SPD division by end of this year and for the next 2 to 3 years?
So we are currently expanding our SPD division. And we are expecting that to be commissioned by sometime around middle of Q1 of next year. So this year we will be continuously doing our regular, which we do about 3,000 tons a month. Mm-hmm. So towards the end of next year, you can say FY22, we will be reaching 6,000 tons per month. So it will be commissioned by, let's say, May or June. And then there is a ramp-up phase if we reach our full capacity.
And so how much are we spending for this expansion for 3,000 tons?
So the total in capex is around 190 crores.
Okay. And so just to understand now, in your commentary, you mentioned regarding the merging or the probably some scheme of arrangement between the entire stainless steel group. Now with the improvement in the Jindal Stainless performance, is it any possibility for Jindal Stainless Hisar to recover the 900 crores of loans and advances given to the group company?
So
or probably some interest on that part, and then after that we are moving for scheme of arrangement, or what sort of thoughts we are working on it?
So, as we, this board has empowered the committee to evaluate the various options, so that that the committee will evaluate from all the angles. It will be, you know, looking at the all the stakeholder interests, the minority shareholders and the investors and the lenders. So, this will also be considered as a part of scheme of arrangement. And then we will come out with the scheme with the board approval, we will share it. And that will cover this, what you are regarding to the 900 and
Okay, sir. Thank you. That's all from my side.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star 1. We have next question from the line of Saket Kapoor from Kapoor Company. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir, and thank you for the opportunity. Sir, as you have alluded earlier in the Jindal Stainless call also, that Hisar would be the engine for specialty division. And that is where we are putting the capex, and it will be a more margin accretive site going forward, and stainless would be a volume one. So, sir, what kind of consistent PAT margins can we look forward from the Hisar division going forward, sir?
So in terms of that performance, what we have seen in the Q2, you see there is a V-shaped recovery. So that Q1 was because the operation was suspended, and we gradually opened our operations as the market demands grew up in different sectors. And the Q2, you know, it has really helped us in terms of meeting the consumer facing demand from the automobile segment and the auto segment. So which has really helped us to maintain the EBITDA margin in the Q2 around 14,000. So if I look at from the overall, even apart from that, even the SPD division, which has really helped us in terms of achieving that number also, and in looking at the Q3, which is a positive outlook, which we are looking from that, and if I give you the overall guidance for the whole year, it will be ranging around from the 12,500 to 14,000 is the range from the EBITDA margin as a guidance.
Okay. So this was one of the quarter where we have posted higher EBITDA margin, EBITDA per ton. The minus 16,000, closer to 16,000 is not a sustainable one.
So when I say that, because this is a, you know, pent up demand has happened. If you look at when the whole economy stands still in the Q1, and we gradually open up, the different sectors are opened up, and the demand also pent up from the especially from the, you know, the two wheeler segment in the auto sector. And now if you look at the festival season is also going on. So but what the industry looks from the perspective that once this pent up demand is going to be sustained in the Q3 and Q4, but we look at the overall positive sentiment because this holiday segment is also picking up that part for about the festive season. So that's the thing we are saying, that overall year, in spite of all these challenges, so that our guidance means that we will be having maintaining that EBITDA margin of 12,500 to 14,000 on a consistent basis, which we normally will focus on our, you know, special value added products which we deliver from the industry.
Sir, can you give some guidance on the PAT margin front? Because EBITDA per ton is not always very conducive to understand. But what kind of PAT margins which would be more more indicative?
So, if you look at the Q2 numbers, you know, because we look at the volume which we did is around 155 in terms of that the numbers, the sales volume, and with the EBITDA margin. So if you take this as a base, which will be sustaining over the next two quarters also, and overall basis, apart from that, whatever the washout quarter is happening to work.
That means 5.4 is what we have done for this quarter. This is what this could be achievable for the next half also.
Yeah, that's our focus, that we will be continue to focus on that part.
Right, sir. And my question to now Jindal sir, I think so. Sir, more focus on this rationalization of stainless, both the companies and the one roof. Sir, we have studied or found out that there are 4 to 5 criteria on the basis of which the swap ratios and all are considered. And if we take historically also, sir, the stock prices for both these company they trade in a band of say 1.7 to 1.75 if we take the average weighted price for Jindal Stainless versus Hisar. So this would definitely be one of the factors when when the things would be decided on?
So, Saket, good point. This is something that we're deliberating right now, and by next quarter investor call, we'll be able to shine some light. But that's a good point taken by you, and Ramit has noted that down. So, we will evaluate this also. This, what you're saying, is going to be one of the main points anyway.
Didn't get you, sir. Come again. Last point.
I'm saying what you mentioned will be one of the main criteria anyway.
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, we found that a 60-day average period is considered. So, if there is any sort of exaggeration on any of the company's stock prices, that could result in giving advantage or disadvantage to the minority shareholders in any way. We have seen it in one of the cases. I am not going to mention it on an open forum. But we found that if the 60-day average was misused by them in coming to a conclusion to the stock swapping ratio. So this is what I felt and hence reported to you that historically 1.7 is what we are going to get over a period of time. That was my submission part. And now, sir, coming to your subsidiaries performance, sir, if you could give throw light, how have those performed and what is the outlook for H2, sir?
Yes. So our service center subsidiary, JSSL, is performing extremely well. Maybe, we did in Q2, we did a EBITDA of, 24 crores and a net revenue of 500 crores. So, our stainless service center business is doing very well. We expect to continue this. And whatever volume dip that we had is also picked up. So, now we're doing month-on-month 10,000 tons from our service center. Lifestyle performance, because of railway cutting down of its schedules, there has been a dip in lifestyle performance, but we still did a net revenue of 95 crores in Q2 and an EBITDA of 16 crores. But our other businesses in lifestyle are still doing well. The kitchen segment is performing very well. Our Whirlpool business is performing very well. We have been able to add 2-3 more new OEMs into the fold. Havells is with us now. LG is also here with us. We've got approvals to supply to Tata Motors as well, Ashok Leyland as well, from this lifestyle division. So now we're catering to specific segments there, and both of them I expect in H2 also to do very well.
Because this quarter is a total turnaround for the subsidiary performance also. They have contributed to the bottom line in a positive way.
Yes, and we expect that to continue.
That to continue. So just to harp more on it, sir. When we come up with our numbers on the right side, the consolidated numbers do reflect the subsidiary performance. But in the investor presentation, we are not highlighting the console numbers. Any particular reason, sir, why that is only discussed on the open forum and not being encrypted in the investor presentation?
So, second, if you look at that earlier, what we used to happen that we only give you standalone numbers. So, when we started publishing the console numbers, so it is already incorporated in the financial results when we give it to the stock exchanges, and then even as for the press users perspective. So, that gives you already the highlight in terms of how we did in terms of console number, including the subsidiary. Because if I look at the standalone, it only contributes 80% into the total console business. So that's the reason when we give these consolidated numbers, so we don't specifically mention about that, but your point is well taken on that part. That's what we normally, when we have an investor call, we spin you all the numbers, how the subsidiaries are doing that in terms of the performance, right? Specifically on the number part, on the sales volume and the beta market.
Sir, and on the utilization numbers, sir, we are going to be, if this environment remain 100% capacity utilization numbers for the H2 part, I think so. We are closer to 100% now.
The current demand and the growth coming in, we expect it to be running at near 100% or 100% capacity.
Okay. And sir, give the series mix also, sir, 400, 300 and others for the totals, out of the totals.
Yeah, so in terms of this Q2, so in terms of the 200 series were 45% and 300 series were 39% and 400 were 16%. And if I look for the 6 months period time, so the 200 series were in the range of 42%, 300 was 41% and 400 was 17%.
Right, sir. And how have this the graphite prices and the other raw material component in the stores and have played out, and what is the outlook going forward? And also particularly on the ferrochrome prices, we have seen, I think, so some export tax are being contemplated from South Africa. So how would that play on the ferrochrome prices? I think so they are also moved up to 72,000, 73,000. And one OMC auction was also due. Any update on that, sir? How the prices have played?
Well, let me take that one. So first, graphite electrode prices are more stable. You know, they have been hovering at around 275 to 278 rupees per kg. And though we don't guide on the prices, but as of now, they are very much stable at around that level. And as far as ferrochrome prices are concerned, you know, there has been some improvement in the prices, as you had rightly pointed out. It went up to almost 75,000 rupees per ton. But then that was not exactly because of the South Africa issue, but it was more with the domestic related issues, which are now you know, getting normalized, and the prices are also coming down to around 68,000, 69,000 rupees per ton range. So OMC auction, I think, is due on 9th. So we will get a more clarity on that. But we think that they are likely to remain within 65,000 to 70,000 rupees per ton range.
Okay. So currently they are trading in 68,000 to 69,000. This is what you told us.
Yeah.
Yeah. Currently price is that one. Yes.
Okay. Thank you for the answer. I'd like to come to that. Thank you.
Thank you
again.
Thank you.
And all the best, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star followed by one on your touchtone phone now. We have a next question from the line of Vishal Chandak from MK Global Financial Services. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much for taking my question, and congratulations on a very good set of numbers, sir. So my question was with respect to, you know, how do we look at these two subsidiaries from a longer term perspective? We often talk about, you know, on this quarter we have got such an EBITDA is this much, but if I have to look at a slightly longer term, you know, like 2 to 3 years horizon, how do you look at these two subsidiaries individually performing, and what is the roadmap for them?
So in terms of our lifestyle, which is a consumer facing business, we see huge potential in that business. I mean, like the way the infrastructure and AVC segment is growing in the country, if you see now elevators are coming in, stainless steel infrastructure, railway infrastructure, station infrastructure, airport infrastructure, everywhere from the kind of budgets also government is announced, we see huge demand coming from the consumer facing side. If this is still too early, it is nothing that we have actually tabulated or formulated, but the plan is that in a few years, we would like to take this company public, our lifestyle division. You know, you get a good multiple, EBITDA multiple also, it's a consumer-facing business, we're seeing good traction coming in, business is also stabilizing. So that is the plan in terms of value creation for lifestyle. Steelway being somewhat, you know, connected with the parent business, I think we are just going to grow and expand the number of equipment there, because it helps us in servicing the customers. The whole purpose of the service center is that we provide the best and the quickest service to our customers in that region. So that is what we want to continue. We have drastically improved our supply chain. We've drastically improved our delivery periods, and that is to a huge benefit or a help with the service center company of ours. So that way, there we will just continuously increase our equipment as and when we see the requirements coming.
Great. So I think JSL, as you, the service Steelway you mentioned, you know, would retain be part of the company, and obviously on the lifestyle front, over the next 2 to 3 years, can we really expect, you know, the revenue and the EBITDA to actually more than double from the current levels as and when the opportunities open up, or that would still be a little conservative? We could do even better over here.
I'll be too early for me to actually say that, but it will definitely improve. I can't say if it will double, but it will definitely improve.
And sir, what are the enablers in this case for the lifestyle business? How do we, you know, enable them to do better in terms of revenues? And do we need to do some capex over there, or just need to be a marketing spend over there? How does that work?
It's not on the capex side. It is actually more from the market development and branding advertising side. That is the only thing that was lacking, which now you will see in the next one or two quarters, next year as well. And today, actually, today there is also an ad in HT City and Hindustan Times and all these papers. So that was the thing that was only missing. The product is very good. The quality is best in class. The only thing that was missing is the visibility and the availability of the product. That is what we are working on. And like I said, today also there have been some advertisements that we come out with. And over the next few quarters, you will also see increase in that.
Got it. That is very helpful, sir. Secondly, sir, coming back to the guidance that has been given again over here, the first half EBITDA per ton for the standalone business, we have already crossed 14,100, almost touching 14,200, while we still stand by the full year guidance of 12,500 to 14,000. This would actually give us a downward trend for the 2H, which does not appear so. So, do we plan to revise this guidance for FY21 upwards?
I want to mention about that, because in Q2, we have improved in terms of as well as Q1 because of the lockdown and the operation that started gradually as the different sectors ups in terms of the consumer facing and the auto sector. So we see the positive trend which has been reflected in the Q3, and we are looking in terms of the actual season also as a positive in Q3 also. Yes, though we are giving the guidance, yes, you can take it, from I normally said about 12,500 to 14,000, but you can take it to 15,000. That's what we are expecting with our product mix, what we're having a special product from which we help us to maintain this EBITDA margin. And the overall year basis, with that, what we are trying to focus, that we will be able to sustain with 15,000.
Sure. Thank you very much, sir. That's really helpful.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star followed by 1 on your touchtone phone now. We have next question from the line of Bhavin Chera from Inam Holdings. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Congrats to the top management team for overall good operational performance. Just to highlight on the industry, there have been certain changes in the duty structure. If you can highlight what has happened, or on which products the duty got changed. I think some Indonesian material which was coming, the duty has been levied, and it is for what period? And overall, what's in the stainless steel industry, what kind of custom duties are there on various products?
This is a little detailed question. We can definitely send the second part of it to you, because there are a lot of things and a lot of detailing in that. For the first part, this is a countervailing duty that has come on Indonesia, between 22% to 24%, and right now it is the interim duty that has come, which is there for about 4 months, and in Q4 we expect that the actual duty should come, and it lasts for a period of 5 years.
And which product it is? It's the CR?
All flat products, hot rolled and cold rolled.
Hot rolled and cold. Okay. And if you can, what is the import component now in the industry?
Import, actually, October number is not out. That is why give us another few days, and that also we will send that across.
Okay, thank you. And other thing on the debottlenecking exercise, if any capacity expansion in possible at the Hisar unit?
So Hisar, like we said, the focus is only going to be on value, creating more value. So any capex that we do, it's only going to be adding more value and increasing our special product division. So we've already incurred that capex, and it should be commissioned by Q1 of next year.
Okay, thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. So we have next question from the line of Janil Javeri from JMJ Holdings. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for taking my question, and congratulations on a good result from both the companies. Also, I've been tracking you guys for quite some time, so really appreciate the fact that you all have delivered on everything that you all had promised, even maybe 1.5-2 years back. So congratulations on that too.
Thank you.
That said, one thing I just wanted to understand, so when there's a merger of these two companies, the merger that you all are talking about, so the cross-holding would become a buyback, right? Technically, buyback of the shares. Would the cross-holding shares be extinguished is what I want to understand.
So as we mentioned that, Mr. Jindal also mentioned that that we have formed a committee, board has formed a committee to evaluate the various options and which will be, you know, beneficial from the all the stakeholder perspective, and you know, specifically in terms of that cross-holding, so that we will be coming out with all the options which will be fair to all the stakeholders, including the minority stakeholders, minority shareholders, investors, as well as the lender perspective. So then we will be then coming out with the scheme arrangement which will be approved by the board, we will be sharing with you, which will be beneficial for everyone.
Okay, and even in that, like the value of the lifestyle business that you mentioned, you know, that since it's only part of Hisar, I guess my question that comes out is that the current market cap, it does not reflect any of the things like the debt given to JSL or the valuation that a lifestyle business could get or the cross-holding of the 37% odd stake of JSL in the Hisar price. So I just wanted to understand that, is that something that you all have thought of, or you know, because the current market cap of Hisar is lesser than JSL, which you wouldn't expect that to be.
So thanks for highlighting that point. So that's we mentioned that part, that when we will be coming to the when the committee will evaluate from all the angles, because that's what we want, that being should be fair to everybody.
Market cap,
we are not yet frozen to that sense, and only the committee has given us the power to evaluate. So we are working on that part. So thanks for the point which we have given.
Next quarter, definitely we'll have many more answers to these questions.
Correct.
Okay, fine. Thank you so much and congratulations.
Thank you.
A reminder to participants to ask a question, please press star followed by 1 on your touchdown phone now. We have next question from the line of Saket Kapoor from Kapoor Company. Please go ahead.
Sir, on the debt level, what is our payment schedule for the H2 and how much have been repaid for H1, sir?
So, in terms of the repayments, that we have availed already the moratorium part. So, because we mentioned about that, so we already repaid in the month of October, so in terms of 57 crores, so that is what we are expecting to be, you know, around 75 to 100 crores by the year, as far as the repayment part is concerned.
For more 75 crores for the next half?
Yes, that's what we are expecting, that in the range of 75 to 100 crores. Yes.
75 to 100 crores. So out of, so how will that, what would be the debt figure likely looking, sir, at the end? I think so we have 2,000 crore total debt.
Including the short term debt, so we are at 2,161 crore. So as on 30 September. So we shall talk about that as far as the repayment will happen, because the demand has also picked up, the volume is also going there. So there's a mix of that, the short term working capital need also. So exact numbers we will be sharing you as soon as we progress on the year end, but I gave you the repayment part, how this will look like that.
And what is the capex, sir, that we are going to do for the next half and H1, how much capex we have done?
So if you look at the guidance, normally we give you the maintenance capex for the overall year, it range in the 75 to 150 crore. So if you look at the cash flow which we have published as on 30 September, so we have already spent around 72 crores as on 30 September.
And what are we planning? Same similar figure for the next half also?
Yeah, because we normally give the guidance from 75 to 150 crore for the year as a whole as a maintenance guidance.
Okay. And sir, this CWIP is mainly to the SPD division only, the specialty products that will get capitalized for the first quarter next year, that 140 crore figure.
So it's a mix of many things, because we do the maintenance capex also, which we mentioned about as the overall guidance, and then we talk about the SPD, which we talk about that we are doing that expansion, and because of this COVID, it has got been delayed from that perspective. But if Mr. Jindal also mentioned about that, it should be, you know, commissioned by the next year Q1 in that range, you know. So that so it's a mix of that thing. So many other projects are also there in terms of the CapEx perspective for the routine maintenance CapEx.
The last point, last year we closed at a net debt to EBITDA of 2.3. This time, due to the COVID factor for the first quarter, the first half it rose to 3.2. So, sir, going forward, this year, what is our target of ending with for the net debt to EBITDA number should be?
So, if you look at that, you know, because of this, when you look at the net debt to EBITDA, because it is the 12-month trailing, which we normally consider, and because of, you know, very very depressed quarter in Q1, which we close only 40 crores of EBITDA, so it has gone to that level, what we are talking about that. But as soon as the Q2 performance has, you know, bounced back in terms of as compared to Q1, and looking at the Q3 and Q3 positive, we want to go back to the normal levels. Yeah.
That means 2.2 in the vicinity of 2.2 to 2.3 should be the ideal figure we should end the year.
So as soon as the performance what we are expecting in the Q3 Q4 to be good, so it will come down because that's what we are expecting that
one. Thank you. Thank you, sir, again.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on your touchtone phone now. We have next question from the line of Jeevan Rutt from HNS Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Is the voice audible?
Yes, please.
Yeah, congratulations on, you know, executing whatever you guys have been promising for the last few quarters. A couple of questions, sir. The pent-up demand which you were talking about in the earlier part of the call, do you see it sustaining in this quarter?
So if you look at this this quarter being a festival season, so that demand has also been picked up in all the segments. So basically auto segment is also doing well in terms of that demand because of the festive season. So and looking at the consumer facing segment, if you look at all the industries in terms of that, when we talk about the automobile segment also, it is a consumer facing segment because of this festive season it has picked up. So we're looking at the positive side in terms of the demand sustenance part.
And sir, the one suggestion which I had, you know, the PPT which you guys share after the results, as some of the other speakers have also highlighted, if you can give a segregated presentation on the specialty products division and the subsidiaries, you know, in terms of EBITDA breakup and ROC breakup, I think that will help us in price discovery in the share. This is my suggestion as an investor, because I feel the market cap is still not reflecting the value of the company.
So thanks for pointing out the message. We have noted out that point, so we will evaluate from that end.
And on the EBITDA per ton guidance, which you the EBITDA per ton guidance, do you have any guidance for the rest of the year, sir? Will it be around the same levels?
Yes, we talked about in the call that normally we talk about 12,500 to 14,000. So, but looking at the current the demand, which has been, you know, positive in Q2, and if we are looking at the positive outlook in Q3 and Q4, we can take the EBITDA guidance for the overall year basis. 15,000. Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Sincere apologies if, you know, a few questions are repetitive because we joined a bit late. Anyway, thank you and wish you all the best for the future.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have next question from the line of Devang Sanghvi from ICICI Securities. Please call.
Good afternoon, sir, and congrats on a very good set of numbers. Going forward, we are. Hello?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Going forward, we are focusing on the value side of the business, and just wanted to know what percentage of our product mix is value added in nature currently, and what we are targeting over the next 2-3 years.
So, in terms of that, SPT project, which Mr. Jindal also mentioned about, that we are doing expansion, and which he talks about that we are doing at on a monthly basis 3,000. And which will, once we will get commissioned by the next year Q1, so it will be, you know, goes to from 3,000 to 6,000 level per month. So that's what we're looking from the SPD products. And if you look at the today's scenarios, it's in terms of the Quantity wise, it contributes 7% in the total cart, and in terms of the value wise, if I look at it, comes at 14% range, 10 to 14% range.
So this 7% can go to around 15, say by 2-3 years down the line.
In terms of the capacity, what we have, what Mr. Jindal mentioned about that, so that capacity will go from 3,000 to the 6,000 level.
Right, sir. And the defense segment, which particular areas we are focusing in terms of the market, because we have the approval from the defense authorities?
So, what Mr. Jindal also mentioned about that this is a fairly stainless steel, the special type of the steel which we provide to the defense requirements. So, this is what he mentioned about that part.
Any quantum you can guide on the same one in terms of tons, how much does that go to the defense segment and going forward, where we see this particular volume?
So this is more a special type of the product which we supplied as well as the need of the requirement. So that depends upon how the special kind of the steel which we provide to them. So it depends upon that the requirement from the defense side perspective.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot and all the best for the future performance. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. A reminder to participants, if you wish to ask a question, please press star followed by 1 on your touchtone phone now. As there are no further questions from the participants, I'd now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. I would like to thank everyone for attending this call and for showing interest in Jindal Stainless Hisar Limited. The company is well placed to maximize all opportunities for the remaining part of the current financial year. With this, I hope we have been able to answer all your questions satisfactorily. Should you need any further clarifications or would like to know more about the company, please feel free to contact our investor relations team. Thank you once again for taking the time to join us on this call.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Jindal Stainless Hisar Limited, that concludes this conference call. Thank you for joining with us, and you may now disconnect your lines.